That was a sermonette. All right, family. As I say every time I lead out the prayer in this session, this is my favorite part of service. Because I know I not only pray by myself, I not only pray with people I see all the time, but I pray with every believer of the Lighthouse. And God is going to do mighty things through a church that prays together. And so what we customarily do during the prayer of intercession, I don't think there's any believers, so I don't have to explain that. But our focus of the family today is Sister Zaretha Strong. I don't think I see her, and I did not get the opportunity to speak to her. But we'll pray over her life and her family life anyhow, amen? Also, Elder Bourne, you do not see him today. He was supposed to be here, but you do not see him. And that is because his grandmother failed not only once, but twice. And not only did she have to have one surgery, but she had to have surgery twice. And so we want to pray for Elder Bourne, for him, his family, for his grandmother, for a speedy recovery. And we just want God to move in these, in the lives of Elder Bourne and the lives of Sister Strong. So family, you have heard the prayers. I just want you to join me at the front as we'll kneel before God together. By trees, they worship while it's raining and snowing on them, Father. But we have been shown mercy, we have favor, we have been blessed, God. Our lives, oh Father, are comfortable compared to others, oh Lord. And we pray that you may keep our eyes on the blessings you have given us and not the troubles that sometimes we go through. Lord, we want to seek you this morning. As a body of believers, as a full church, God, we have some things we want to offer up to you, oh Lord. Beginning with Sister Strong, Lord, wherever she may be right now, we pray that you are with her. We pray not only that you are with her, but you are with her daughters, and you are with her husband, you are with her entire family, oh God. We just pray, Father, that your comfort, your peace, your joy will continue to be sprayed all over them, oh Lord. And no matter what troubling times come, no matter what trials come, no matter how much the devil tries to shake them up, oh Lord, we pray that you will keep them in peace. Keep them with a joy in them, oh Lord, that no man can take away. We pray, Father, most importantly, that Sister Strong, her daughters Jasmine and Jessica, her husband, and all the family will be saved, oh God. We can pray that their finances be better. We can pray that their health would be better. We can pray that they have wisdom, Lord. But all that means nothing if they are not saved, oh God. So we pray now, Lord, that wherever they are, Lord, you will begin to work on them. and whatever type of relationship we have, that you have with them, that it would increase, Father, so much so that when you return, oh God, that you would take them with you back into that place that will last forever, oh God. We pray for Elder Lawrence, Lord. We pray for his family, especially his grandmother, who's failed twice and now has had two surgeries. We pray, God, that what doctors cannot do, you will do. Father, that what human hands cannot fix, Father, we pray that you would. Lord, we pray that a miracle would happen in this situation. That's what it's going to take, oh God. This is out of human hands. This is out of human wisdom, Father. Now it has to be divine help. And so we pray to you, Father, if the grandmother could just touch your hem, she would be healed, Father. So we pray you will position yourself right next to her, oh God, that she may receive some of that healing, Lord, that you always bestow on us. And we just pray, Father, at the end of the day, Lord, whatever comes, wherever the chips fall, whatever may come, oh God, we pray that the grandmother will serve you. We pray that Elder Lawrence will serve you. We pray that his family will serve you. We pray that everyone, Father, will serve you no matter what happens. We pray that you would receive glory, oh God. Be with this Lighthouse Church, Father. Forget us not. Give us the strength to carry your message out into this community. Give us the strength, oh God, to live a life that will draw people closer to you. This we do pray, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. So God gives us an opportunity to show. I give you 100%. I just want you to give 10% back in a faithful offering. So I invite everyone to participate. Get your checkbooks out. Put them hands in the wallets. Pull that scrap change out that you saved for a rainy day. Also, if you ain't got no funds on you, that's all right. Pull your cell phone out. Go to thelighthouse.org. Lighthouse.sa.org, you can give online. We gonna get some money in God's house, ain't we? We gonna be less worshipers, ain't we? We not gonna be first worshipers today. I invite the officers to come in. I'll bless them with a prayer and then send them forth. Let's pray, family. Father, we just thank you, God. We thank you, God, that you give to us. And we know this because we can give back. And we just pray, Father, as we give, Lord, this is us saying we put our trust in you. We put our trust that our family is going to be taken care of. We put our trust that our bills going to be taken care of. We put our complete trust in you, Father. Even more than that, we're saying if those things are not taken care of, we're going to serve you anyhow. And so we just pray, Father, that you will bless what we give. Double it and use it to grow your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Reencourage ourselves. never failed us yet. So this is praise and worship. So that means it's participatory. That means we're not going to stand up here and sing to you because we're lifting these praises to God. So if you want to join with us as we sing, we've come this far by faith.
Come this far by faith.
Thank you, Lord. it on our own. We've done it because God is faithful. He's holy. He's all that. So God, because you're faithful, because you're holy, because you're all that, we will declare from our mouth that, Lord, you are faithful. So this simple song is just acknowledging God and who he is towards us. God, I call you faithful. I call you all that. I call you righteous. See, we have to become aware. We have to acknowledge who God is. So we're just going to acknowledge him now. We're just going to worship you, God. Worship you, God. You're all that. You're faithful, holy. And we worship you, God. Oh, we love to declare who you are. Yeah. I call you holy. Your name is holy. You are so holy to me. I call you holy. Your name is holy. Holy you are, and holy you'll be.
You begin to say yes through your storms and your trials. You say yes. holy. Your name is holy.
Beginning at 12, and if you're feeling a little bit more spiritual than any other day, we invite you to come out and help us set up and get the festivities going. Also, where is Mike Burton? I think he in the sound. Well, come on out of hiding, brother. Come on now. I don't know if many of you know, but today is Mike Burton's last Sabbath with us. Yeah, say all. Mike, he's, I don't know if he's gonna get me for calling him up, but are you gonna get him? Okay. All right. I got a few hours for the Sabbath, and I'll find somewhere. But just tell us where you're going, man. We just want to know so we can pray after you leave. Just let us know. He's going to Memphis. Man, isn't that where Pastor Hines' church is? Man, I think it's called Overton Park. So definitely check him out, man. He's cool. He's nice, man. Know that our prayers are going with you. Man, we appreciate what you've done in the booth. We thank you, man. That's all. So remember Mike in your prayers. Family, let's turn our words to James 2. James 2. Verse 14 to 19, James 2, verses 14 to 19. When you're there, say, I'm with you. Ooh, Catherine, you got there fast. I know them apps take a little longer to open up sometime. I'll give you a few more minutes. Give you a few more seconds. When you get there, say I'm with you. Verse 14, I'm reading, you are listening. Verse 14, what good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also, faith by itself, if it does not have works, if it does not have works, faith by itself is dead. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one? I tell you, you do well. But I tell you this also, even demons believe and they shudder. Using for our sermon title today, put your faith on display. Put your faith on display. Let us pray, family. Father, we just thank you, God. The most exciting part of the week for me, I get to dive in the Word and learn with all of the believers. So, Father, as you teach your people who listen, teach me as well who speaks. Because I'm just a vessel, God. They see me, but they surely hear you. So we pray, Father, that your Word go forth, that your will go forth, that your Spirit is released upon all us. That when we leave here, oh Father, we take this message and show it to the world. This we do pray. In Jesus' name, amen. There are many people who say they believe and know the truth that Jesus not only is the Son of God, but that in fact, Jesus is God. Amen. Lighthouse family, I've come to tell you there are thousands upon thousands of Christians who profess that they believe in the mission that Jesus had when he came to this earth. How he left the comforts of heaven, by the Spirit was placed in Mary's womb, that he not only lived and died for all of humanity's sins, but we profess with our lips that he rose up on a Sunday morning with victory and power over death. I come to tell you, it's not rare for people to say they believe in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. We as believers, we as Christians, we as Adventists, we cling to the promises of the Word, don't we? Talk to me. We do. We study them. We memorize them. And we quote these promises in times of difficulty. We hold these promises dear to our heart because we believe that God is not like man that he should lie, but if God has said it, surely he will do it. It's not rare for people to believe in the promises of God. We remember the scriptures where Jesus say, I go to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. We believe these scriptures. We believe that God is going to return one day, that Christ is going to return one day. We say we believe this, that he's going to take us to a place without worries. A place where there is no point, no pain. A place where there is only joy in this land. We can't wait till Christ come back and take us to this everlasting place of nonstop worship. We just want to sing hymns all the day long in the presence of holy angels. It's not rare for people to believe that a heaven exists. It's not rare for people to say that Jesus is all powerful with their lips. They say he's Alpha and Omega, and we say with our lips that if Jesus just say it, it will be so. I've come to tell you that it's not rare for people to say, profess with their lips, they believe in God. If you're following me, say I'm with you. I've also come to tell you that there were thousands, thousands upon thousands of Christians from different denominations, from different cultures, from different ways of life, who say that the Bible is the infallible word of God. That's not rare. It's not rare for people to say that it doesn't matter what the world says about the Bible, how much they try to prove that it is fake or fake. Tishes, as I will serve God with all my heart. Lighthouse family, I've come to tell you there are a lot of people that say they believe in the word of God. That's not rare. But what is rare is someone who will say they believe in the word of God, but also live out the word of God. In today's time, it's becoming common for someone to say a lot. Talk about it. Yet their actions do nothing. I've noticed that in this world today, a lot of people talk a lot. We profess a lot. We believe a lot. We say our opinion a lot. Yet our lives do not back up what we say. There are a lot of people that seem to know a lot. That's not rare. But there are only a few who let what they know develop a Christ-like character in them. It's one thing to know about Christ. It's another thing to live like Christ. Amen. Amen. Family of God, we got a nice little health message, don't we? Awesome. I mean, God, he's given us, he's written in his word, the vegetation. If he can't reproduce itself, we probably shouldn't be eating it. If it don't grow from the ground, we probably shouldn't be eating it. And then we that wasn't enough for us. We was like, listen, you said Jesus ate lamb, people ate birds. That ain't enough for us. And so Jesus was like, okay. The Bible ain't enough for you. I'll give you inspiration. I'll send a prophet your way. I'll let her write books about the health message. And we understand. We have fruits, nuts, what else? Somebody help me out. Grains and vegetables. Look at me. I don't even know the health message. Lord, have mercy. You know. And we know what we should do. You know what we should do. But what's becoming popular is people knowing what they should do, yet doing what they shouldn't do. I mean, it's nice. It's nice. The vegan chicken is nice, but sometimes you just want some steak and potatoes.
Ooh, come on now.
Dang, help me. Sometimes you just want some steak and potatoes. And though we know we should take care of our bodies better, God has told us, I need you around a little bit longer. So I'm giving you this health message. I need you to take care of your bodies. But sometimes, though we know what we should do, though we say what we should do, though we stand up and preach what we should do, the preacher sometimes outside of the church do what he shouldn't do. It was Paul in Romans chapter 7, verse 19. What did he say? The good I want to do, I do it not. But the evil I don't want to do, this I do. We're becoming people who know what to do, who want to do it, yet we do the exact opposite. I'm so glad, family. I'm so glad, family, that Jesus, our great example, he was not like this. But Jesus, what he believed, he surely lived out. If Jesus said it, surely he would do it. If Jesus wanted someone else to do it, he would lead by example. If he preached it, if he read it from the scrolls, if he asked you to do it, surely Jesus would show you how to do it. I'm so glad that our great example, Jesus, lived out what he said. You remember Jesus? Jesus in Mark chapter 1. Jesus in Mark chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. You remember this story. Jesus, now you got to understand, Jesus, one of his greatest beliefs was that he must spend time with the Father. How many of us believe that? You got to spend some time with the Father. If you want to do the work of the Lord, then you got to spend time with the Lord. Some of us, the first thing we do is pull out our iPhones, pull out our notepads, the Note 5, and we get on Facebook first thing in the morning, checking the notifications. Some of us, the first thing we do is we feed ourselves. Some of us, we wake up with morning breath. We got to brush some teeth first. But Jesus understood that if I'm going to do the work of the Lord, then I got to be about what I talk about. If I know I got to spend time with God, then that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to spend time with God. It don't matter what comes my way. It don't matter what happens. It don't matter what people say. It don't matter what I got to do. If I did to do God's will, I will spend time with God first. Before I eat, before I get on my iPhone, before I do anything else, I'm going to spend time with God. I told my followers to do it. I believe it. Now I will be the example, and I surely will do it. So in Mark chapter 1, verses 29 to 39, Jesus, he's healing people all day long. The Bible says he's in a sanctuary and he heals a man on a Sabbath day. How many of us know we can have healing on a Sabbath day?
Amen.
And so when Jesus leaves the sanctuary, he goes to Peter's mother-in-law house. And so there along with him, he has the sons of thunder, James and John. Mm. Ooh, them bad attitude boys. but Peter's mother-in-law, she lays with a fever. And Jesus raises her up. Now, what this does, this strikes everyone's attention in the city. The city hears about Jesus healing this lady. Now, the whole city comes out to be healed. My God, what if the Lighthouse did something that had the whole city coming to be healed? When the last time we had the whole city knocking at our doors, running over people, I can imagine it'll be like Black Friday. I have people busting down the doors, waiting overnight. If people can do that for a PS4, how much more should they do it for Jesus? But Jesus, he's got the whole city at the door. The Bible says Jesus is healing folk all night. He turns no one away. The whole city is healed. Folk with leprosy is healed. Folk with headaches are healed. Folk with bad attitudes are healed. Characters are changed. Leprosy is healed. Everybody is getting healed. The Bible says that Jesus was up all night long. But this is what gets my attention the most. Though Jesus is up all night long, the Bible says that before the sun came up, he was up spending time with God. Though Jesus probably was like, man, it's too many people here. I'm going to be healing these folk all night. But yet and still, I'm going to get up early in the morning and spend time with Jesus. When things come our way that happen unexpectedly, when things come our way that we didn't think was going to happen, that should not change what happens with our relationship with Christ. Though Jesus probably got no sleep, he knew that for today's work, that was yesterday's work. But what the time I spent with God would not be enough then, but today I need to be refreshed. So though my schedule has been thrown off, though I didn't expect to be healing all these people all night long, I will get up anyhow. Not us. Not us. We stay up and watch a TV show. We didn't hit the snooze button 5 times in the morning. We didn't memorize where the snooze button at in our sleep so we can hit it and keep sleeping. We go through a little bit of adversity. We stay over work 3-4 hours. Now we can't spend no time with God. When the schedule changed, our relationship changed with Christ. Just a little bit change. My daughter got on my nerves. Now, Lord, I can't have time to spend with you. We believe we need to spend more time with God. And yet, when it's easy to do, we do it. But when the circumstances change, just a little shakeup of the schedule, and now we can't spend time with God. A party went over just a little bit longer. Now we can't spend time with God. But God is saying, if you're going to do my work, if you're going to say you are me, if you're going to preach it, if you're going to teach it, no matter what happens in the circumstances, I need you to be a man. I need you to be a woman of your word. Spend time with me no matter what happens. Sometimes you're going to be up late. Sometimes people are going to get on your nerves. Sometimes you're not going to feel like praying. Sometimes stuff is going to drag you away. But if you're going to call yourself one of my people, the schedule or circumstance change don't affect our relationship. Someone dies. You don't spend much time with the Lord. We lose our job. We don't want to spend time with the Lord. But Jesus was different. Because though Jesus went through things, though Jesus was persecuted, though Jesus was talked about, lied about, though people criticized him, he went through all things. Jesus had people who loved him, but there were people who hated him. But he did not let the outside noise affect his relationship with Christ. There are two types of noises. There are noise that go outside, that goes on outside your mind. There is noise that go on inside your mind. Jesus did not let what happened on the outside affect what goes on in his inside. I've noticed something about us. I've seen a lot of people quote scriptures, quote them good. We like to quote them humbling scriptures, don't we? Psalms 25, verse 9, the Lord is with those who are humble. We like to say it, we like to say it. I promise you, I was at a church. I won't say what church, I won't even say what day of the church. Sometimes we just like to talk about other churches at times. I won't even say what time, what day. But I'm at a church and this lady, I'm like, she is blessing my soul. She is up there speaking, she is up there praising, she is up there preaching. She was even speaking in tongues. I know we call that the devil language, but this lady is blessing my soul. And she and the next thing I turn around, I go in the hallway and she's on the phone cussing somebody out. I said, ain't that what James saying, James 3? He said, with this tongue we bless our Lord and Father. But with this tongue we will cuss somebody out. I say, this lady mom go both ways. She just blessed me, but now she just cussed somebody. It's like, you just put me in heaven, but you just put that person in hell. You just gave me a blessing and turned right around. You was just reading scripture. Terry was telling me, like you was just about to preach the gospel. Now you having trouble holding back from slapping somebody. I mean, lady, you said a lot, but I need your life to look like what you say. Because though you blessed me in the sanctuary, when I saw you outside, I was totally turned off. Though you blessed my spirit, you nullified it when I saw you do the exact opposite. And so now I don't want to come back to your church. Because I believe I can get the same thing in the world. I believe you are a hypocrite. Because you talk real well in front of elders, but when I see you around fine ladies, fellas, talk to me. Fellas, talk. Hey, don't you get quiet in this church now. You better talk to me. You sound real nice in front of elders. You sound real nice in front of church members. But when I see you around some fine ladies, when I see you around your family, when I see you around worldly people, you get along with the church and the world. It's one thing to say a lot. It's another thing to do a lot. James 2:18. The Bible says, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You reading this? You reading this? Now in this scripture, I looked at it. And I said, there are two types of believers in this scripture. If you would look at it, the first believer is a believer that has faith, but does not have works. Show me your faith apart from your works. That is the first believer. And then James gives us a second believer. This believer is a believer that shows his faith by his works. You have a first believer. I would like to call this believer a contingency believer. This is a believer that shows their faith apart from their works. You with me? Because this believer faith is based off how they feel. Stick with me. This believer serves the Lord based off their current circumstances. If I feel like being spiritual today, then I'll study the word today. Right? But if I don't feel like it, then I don't want nothing of the Lord. If I'm agitated today, I'm cool on God. If somebody got on my nerves today, I'm good on you, Lord. Let me calm down. But when I'm being blessed, but when I'm being happy, and I'm feeling spiritual, I'm at church and I'm singing praise team songs, and I'm hearing people pray, and I'm having spiritual conversations. Oh, I want to pray now. A contingency believer. This type of believer is easily distracted from what God has called them to do. Because their faith is based off circumstances, it's easy to do the work of the Lord when your faith is based off circumstances. Because when you're doing the work of the Lord, surely you're going to go through some persecution. Amen. All who desire to live godly shall suffer persecution. So if your faith is based off what is happening to you, then surely you will be easily distracted from what God has called you to do. Sometimes to complete the mission of God, you're going to have to go through some persecution. And if your faith can't hold you through it, then surely you won't do the work of God. Your girlfriend might leave you, but you're going to have to work. Your family might be tired of you, but you're going to have to work. You might lose your job. You might lose your finances. You might lose your home. But the Lord's work has to go forth. But if your faith is based off contingencies, if your faith is based off situations, then surely you can't do the Lord's work. You're too busy looking at what's happening instead of what you're supposed to be doing. This is a contingency believer. God has given this believer a mission to do. And so while they're doing this mission, they're not really worried about, they want God to receive glory. But this type of believer is worried about getting a little glory for themselves.
Okay, amen.
Don't let it get quiet here. This type of believer is waiting. I can't wait to get my turn. I got to get up there and I got to preach and show the world what I can do. This type of believer wants to do work for the Lord, yet their main mission is to get seen by the people they witness to. They're looking for a little glory. You remember the mother of James and John? Lord, can my son sit on the left and to the right of you? But Jesus told them, you don't know what you asked for. Can you drink the same cup that I drink? The this person really wants to be seen. I mean, if Pastor was here, I'll tell Pastor, this person wants your job. Because they want to run the church. They want everybody to listen to them. They don't want to be followers, but they want to be followed. Because when this contingency believer, when someone tries to tell them something, they're not strong enough in the Lord to look at it spiritually, but they look at it in their feelings, and now they're hurt and leave the church. Can't say nothing to a contingency believer. Because when things don't go that way, my Lord, mercy, it's quiet up in here. This type of believer is like ten out of the 12 spies that went to Canaan. They go forth at the command of the Lord. They love the benefits of serving God. They see the land and they want the land. It looks like nothing but pleasure. It looks beautiful. They want to go forth, but when they see an Amalekite, when they see a Jebusite, when they see they got to go through some stuff to get what the Lord has destined for them, they don't want it no more. Ain't no fight in a contingency believer. And that's why contingency believers walk out the church. I gotta say it. This type of believer is like David, chilling on the rooftop of his palace, enjoying the rich life when he's supposed to be on a battlefield with his brothers. When the church is going out to do missionary work, go door to door, this type of believer is sitting in the sanctuary. We've been there. When the AY leader makes a prayer walk, this type of believer has other plans on the Sabbath day. Speak to me, Lord. When it's time for the church to do work, you can't find a contingency believer. Because his faith is based off how he feels. If I feel this is not effective, I won't do it though God has called me to. My Lord, you have to be careful of this type of believer, church, because he looks like Christ. He even talks like Christ. Sometimes do the acts of Christ, quote scriptures like Christ, but in fact, this contingency believer is nothing like Christ, because this believer's faith is based off contingencies. They serve Christ only when it's beneficial to them. But let's move on. That's another type of believer presented by James. A believer that will show their faith by their works. You have your contingency believer, what I say? Contingency believer who serves Christ only when the circumstances seem right. But there's another type of faith presented in the Bible. This faith that is totally different from a contingency believer. This second believer is a believer that I like to call a sold-out believer. Because this believer will show his faith. He will prove his faith by what he do. That is the type of faith Christ is looking for. Let's talk about this believer. This type of believer is that believer you call when you see. How many of us got a person on speed dial? You call this person. I know they're going to pray for me. Uh-huh. Listen, your relationship might not be right with the Lord at times, but you know this person got a relationship. God might not listen to me right now, but God surely going to listen to this person. Hey, God might not listen to my mother right now. God might not listen to the doctors right now. But if I can call this person, I know they're going to pray for me. Some people you ask to pray for you, they forget, and I hear we mean well, but we don't. But you know if you ask this person, they're going to pray for you. This person, I like to say has an old school faith. Talk to me. Old school faith. What you think about when you see an old school faith? That faith that can't be shook. That faith that no matter what happens, I'm going to serve the Lord. That faith that when Peter tells you a lie, you say, Satan, get thee behind me. You are an hindrance to me. I'm talking about that faith when you, how many of us forget where you put them car keys? You about to be late for work? The devil is a lie. I'm talking about that faith. You start calling the devil a lie about everything. My shoe missing. The devil is a lie. I can't find my tie. The devil is a lie. My kids acting up. Devil, you're a lie. I'm talking about that old school faith. You get to praying about everything. I can't remember this answer. The devil is a lie. That old school faith that blame everything on Satan. I didn't put on a pound and a half. Devil, you're a lie. That old school faith that I have you sleeping peacefully in the midst of the storm. When everyone's running frantically, throwing water off the boat, looking for Jesus, you got a pillow sleeping peacefully through the storm. Because you got a connection with God that though you're in the middle of a tornado, though you're in the eye of a hurricane, what goes on the outside of you doesn't affect what happens on the inside of you. My Lord, mercy, mercy, mercy. See, I love this this sold out believer, because through financial problems, this person has peace. Through hunger, through lack, this person has peace. Through turmoil, through unexpected trials, this person has peace. They kind of like Paul, through the ups and through the downs, I've learned the secret of being content. It's because I have established myself in the Lord. So what happens to me, it really doesn't matter. I'm going to be here. When people talk about me, I'm going to be here. You're going to see me serving. When people don't want me here, I'm going to be here. If my car get repoed, if my house get repossessed, if whatever happens, this sold out believer has made up in their mind, I'm going to be here. I'm going to be here. Say what you want about me. You're going to see me in a pool pit. I might not dress like you. It might not be going my way, but I'm going to be here. Through the lion's den, I'm going to be here. In the furnace, I'm going to be here. I'm going to march forward until these Jericho walls come tumbling down. For 7 days, I will march without food or water. But my faith is based in Christ. So whether I have it or whether I don't, my faith will be in Christ. You can see me with clothes on. I'm going to serve Christ. You can see me naked with stripes on my back. I'm going to serve Christ. With a TV, I'm going to serve him. Homeless, I'm going to serve him. No matter what happens, whether living or dead, even in death, because this sold out believer is not based off contingency. It's not based off circumstances. And what Christ is looking for in these last days, because a storm is coming, is a believer whose faith will be firm in him no matter what happens, no matter what comes his way. Jesus knows that persecution is coming. Injustice will continue. Black on black crime will continue. We will witness through it all. But if our faith is based off circumstances, we will be shook and our faith will fail us. Show me your faith apart from words, and I'll show you my faith by my words. Mercy, mercy, mercy. I'm closing soon. There are two reasons why God wants us to show our faith. There are two. You can play, Sister Tammy. There are two reasons why God wants us to show our faith. Something nice and soft. Get the spirit in you. Yeah. One reason is like we already. Well, one reason God wants us to put our faith on display. He wants our faith to move through trials. We know that. He wants our faith to continue, no matter what we go through. No matter if we're a king like David, or we're going through it like Job, my faith should be at ease. And so, the reason Jesus wants this, because your faith may save someone else. If they see your faith through trials, through success, through it all, what word can you speak against that? Then on the other hand, a person with faith, but what he does not back up his faith, that person confused the world. And that's why God can say, I'd rather you be hot or cold and not lukewarm. Lukewarm people are the death of the gospel. Because people see hypocrites and run from them. If we say one thing with our lips and do one thing with our actions, this church will not grow. That's why God would rather you be cold, just be in the world, but don't halt my gospel. Don't be in my church, praising my name. Don't say you are of me. Don't claim me. And then go out into the world and do exactly as they do. But at least make an effort. At least try. At least get up and do something. But don't just say I am of Christ and live how you want to. I'd rather you be cold. I'd rather you be hot than be lukewarm. Elders, you're praying. Leaders, you're praying. You're praying right now. If this word has touched your heart, if this word has touched your heart, and I'll be the first one, because I haven't always done, I know it. I haven't always done what I said I know I should do. But maybe this word has touched your heart, and you know there have been some things you should have done, but you shouldn't. I just want people to come up who desire an authentic relationship with God. That if I'm going to say it, surely I'm going to try to live it. I will give everything in me to serve Christ to the best of my ability. If that is you, I just invite you to join me at the altar. Let's talk to God about it. Let's reason with God. Let's reason with God. Elders, you're praying that a heart would choose Christ. I no longer want to be that person who looks good in church but is filthy in the world. But Christ, I want to give my life to you. Because I know that these are the last days. And the wheat are going to be separated from the tare. Because a storm is brewing, trial is coming. And if my faith is based off what happens to me, then surely my heart will fail before Christ come. Just a few more seconds for you to choose. Let's pray. Father, we're up here because we know we need you. We have an issue in our heart that can't be fixed by man's power alone. And so, Father, with each and every individual under the sound of my voice is praying for a heart that will please you, oh God. We know a lot, God, as Adventists, we know a lot. But Father, we want to back up what we know with what we do. So if we say we're going to be a people of love, God, we're going to love our brother. As James put it, if we see a homeless man, we're not just going to pray for him, but we're going to feed him. If we say, Father, we want to lose our attitude, Father, then before we respond, God, we want to pray to you. Before we react, God, we want to pray to you. We want to be people who are more than what we say. We want to put our faith on display for the world. That the world might not even have to open up a Bible, but when they look at us, they read scriptures because we look just like the scriptures. We talk just like the scriptures. We act just like the scriptures, Father. And we know, God. We know, Lord, that there will have to be effort on our part. So please, Father, give us the strength to not leave this sanctuary hoping to do well, but failing to accomplish that. Keep us every moment of our lives, oh God. Let us live like you. That's what we desire. Because them promises we believe in, that heaven we believe in, we want to be there, oh God. So before I close, elders, your eyes are open. We're looking. Maybe there's someone whose heart has been touched. You want to go a little further than a prayer to God right now. You want Bible study. You just want a prayer partner. You want somebody to check up on you. You just want somebody to think about you. Maybe just call me once a week and let's pray and study together. Just raise your hand. Just raise your hand. And the elder will come to you. Or Bible worker will come to you. More seconds. How can I preach this sermon without asking, making a baptismal call? If you want to go into that watery grave, you receive something from God and you just want to rededicate your life to Him, you can just raise your hand. Father, we just thank you, God, for the word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Because of the blood of Jesus.
Hey, Mommy.
we can boldly come before you and cast our cares on you because you care for us. Lord, we just thank you for being who you are. And we pray now that as we prepare to go forth and face this cruel world, this sick and dying world, that you will give us the faith to do what you've appointed us to do. Give us the courage to say what we should say. And as Elder Wright preached today, help us to do what we say we are about. That's it. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We give you honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Ushers will. Thank you.